Psychologist Brian Sackett spoke to South Bay IANS in Saratoga, California recently. His presentation included the death of his wife, the work of John of God in Brazil, his work as a psychologist dealing with spiritual experiences, and incidents from his own life. Brian says, life and death and life after death are all things that move through us and our awareness, and us and our awareness is changeless, and it is outside of time and space. This is the first time that Brian has talked publicly about his experience.
Well, first of all, I want to thank John for all the work he does. As you know, he hosts these groups. And I also want to thank him for the encouragement that he's given me to come up here and speak. So what we're going to do today is I'm going to talk for a while. And it's a crowded talk. There's lots of things, lots of details that I'm actually going to probably skip over. We'll have a break later and then a question and answer period. If I do skip over something, hopefully you can ask questions and I can clarify. But I just can't cover all of this, so I am going to talk about the passing of my wife and some of the things we did to try to help her heal from her thyroid cancer. But I'm not going to go into great depth with that. That could be a whole other talk. So one of the reasons that I wanted to talk was that as I've been attending this group and learning more about near-death experiences, from going down to the Newport Beach conference last August, I'm beginning to see that near-death experiences are not necessarily just the going through a tunnel, seeing dead loved ones, having a life review, and meeting extraordinarily spiritual beings. There's actually many variations on that. And some of the experiences I'm going to talk to you about today are examples of that. I don't know if any of you read the last monthly Ian's thing, but I brought it along because this isn't a typical near-death experience, but it really duplicates a lot of the middle experience that I'm going to be talking to you about. So just to give you a framework, what I believe happens, what I believe is true, is that life and death and life after death are all things that move through us and our awareness. And us and our awareness is changeless. It's outside of time and space. Time and space and these other things move through it. And so some of what I experienced tells me that that's true, and so part of the purpose of this is to try to share that with you and see if it makes sense to you guys. A little bit about myself. So I am a psychologist in private practice. This is the first time that I'm actually talking publicly about these kinds of experiences. There's some pressure in psychology to be kind of straight and narrow, and so I'm starting to step outside of that. I've kind of had a dual life. I've had my therapy practice that I do, and then I have a spiritual group that meets monthly that I lead, and I've kind of kept them separate, and now I think it's time to bring both of those together. So psychology is a mid-career transition for me. I spent 25 years working in high tech. I started out as a physics major in Stanford for my undergraduate degree and switched to a math major. And then after that, I spent, as I said, these years in high tech working in sales or marketing, application engineering, engineering program management. So I have a background that was very science-oriented, and I think I retained that skepticism. I did go back to graduate school to the Institute of Transpersonal Psychology, and have been practicing as a therapist. I specialize in my therapy practice in working with trauma and abuse primarily. I deal with depression, anxiety, and I do some couples counseling. So that's a little bit about who I am. One of the things I wanted to talk about was spiritual emergence. This middle experience I'm going to talk to you about was in 1970, and it was about 20 years before that term was coined by Stan and Christina Groff. Stan's a psychiatrist, and there are different categories of spiritual emergence. It's strong spiritual experiences that then you, on a personality level, have difficulty integrating. So the most well-known of the categories is near-death experiences, but kundalini awakenings, psychic openings, strong unitive experiences, alien abduction kinds of experiences are all categories of spiritual emergence. And it's important because there's often a spiritual emergency component of spiritual emergence where for a couple of weeks to a couple of months, it can look a lot like psychosis or schizophrenia. And unfortunately, a lot of mental health professionals diagnose it that way. And and that's a mistreatment of that particular thing, because if you don't treat it that way and you just keep people safe, then there's a natural integration. In spiritual emergence, you often turn away from materialistic orientation. You become much more service-oriented, much more spiritual. So I'm going to talk to you about a prime example of what was spiritual emergence and which was misdiagnosed. First of all, I wanted to talk about my first near-death experience. So that's me on the right. You probably can't see that very well, but I'm 3 years old in this picture. And when I was three, my parents had a Nash Rambler car, very much like this. Right? We were living in Columbus, Ohio, and we were visiting relatives in Minnesota. And we were on the way home from that, and in Wisconsin, my mom and dad were in the front seat. My one-year-old brother was there with them. I was 3 and a half. My older brother was almost 6. We were in the back seat, and we were messing around, and I must have hit the door handle. We were going 60 miles an hour and along a two-lane highway, and I hit the door handle. The door, back door popped open, and the wind sucked me out. So this is what I saw. This is actually my first memory. I have this really strong memory of seeing a very, very bright light and being terrified. So my parents told me, look, Brian, you fell out of the car when you were 3. You had 10 stitches in the back of your head, and you were fine. And I believed that for some years. But I think the reason I became a psychologist is because there's something unconscious, on an unconscious level, that really was bothering me. It had a strong, strong impact on me. And I had to find out what that was. So I'm going to jump around a little bit. I'm going to try to stay a little chronological, but I have to jump some. Some of the ways that I knew that I wasn't okay, in my psychology training, I did psychodrama training. And in psychodrama, you act out scenes, and there's a natural regression back to a younger state. And in one of those psychodramas, I found myself lying on my back on the floor, crying and reaching up my arms. tears, and I didn't know what was going on, but I had the feeling I was crying for my mother. When I went back to graduate school, I wanted to explore, okay, so what the heck happened to me when I was three? And so I had a professor who was an excellent hypnotherapist. His name was Arthur Hastings at ITP. And he did a couple of regressions for me and brought me back to that time. And what I felt in those regressions is immense pain. I couldn't breathe. It was like cut glass, trying to get one breath, much less a lot of breaths. So again, I knew something really, really strong had happened to me. So after that, I called up my mom and dad, and they said, "Hey, what happened? You know, what do you guys remember when I fell out of the car?" And they said, "Okay, well, you fell out of the car, we drove on a little ways, and we noticed you were gone, we turned around, and there was a trucker, and you were in his arms, and there was blood streaming everywhere, and the trucker said you flew out of the car and you landed on your head in the gravel by the road." And so they got in the car and they drove 30 miles to the nearest little clinic, and I had been knocked unconscious. They took me in, they gave me to the people to clean up, and my mom and dad both went into the restroom, and they threw up and they each had diarrhea. So you know that they were scared out of their mind. So the nurse told my mother, he woke up and he started screaming and thrashing around, so we wrapped him up in a sheet and we tied him down and we cleaned him up and gave him 10 stitches. And they said, take him home, don't let him fall asleep because we're worried about concussion. And on the drive between Wisconsin and Ohio, I was on the back seat, my mom had put a pillow in her lap and my head was resting on the pillow. And she said I was crying and reaching for her, but she was afraid I was so hurt that she wouldn't hold me and hug me and comfort me. So subjectively, what happened to me was I felt like I was being punished for messing around, and I was in the worst pain of my life, and my mom just wouldn't do anything. And I think deep down, I not only thought my mom turned away from me, I thought, you know, God has turned away from me. And I think a lot of this was unconscious. And so trying to find out about this, is, as I said, is what drove me to eventually becoming a psychologist and exploring that. And I have to, you know, to some greater degree. I'll tell you the kind of the conclusion of this in the third experience that I'm talking about. So I'm going to jump from there for a minute. So this is what I look like. I'm four in these pictures. I'm the one on the right there. And this is me as a senior in high school. And this is me at Stanford in Austria. I'm the one that's up there on third from the top, I mean the third row from the top, second one in. So the reasons I'm showing this is because, as I said, I was a physics major for a couple of years and a math major at Stanford. This was in my senior year. Now, I went there from 1967 to 1971. And if you'll recall that time, it was the height of the Vietnam War protests. I was suspended from school for a quarter, my spring quarter of my junior year, for protesting. And I was subjectively in a lot of anguish. It was so polarized during that time that you were either for the war or against the war, and it split up families, and it was just, it was a terrible time emotionally. Furthermore, I had taken some classes in the summer, and so that fall quarter in my senior year, I was going to graduate. And graduating meant I was going to be drafted. And I had no solution for that because I strongly objected to the war. I didn't want to go and fight. I didn't want to go to prison, and I didn't want to go to Canada. I was just stuck. So that's kind of the state of mind that I was in. And this guy is Baba Ram Dass. This picture was taken that year in 1970. And Baba Ram Dass and Swami Muktananda came in October of 1970 to Dinkelspiel Auditorium. And some friends of mine told me about it, and I went. So I'm going to leave it here for a little bit. So I had always been interested in spirituality, but I had no frame of reference for this whatsoever. I had some friends that were in something called the Ananda Marga Yoga Society that were meditators, and they're the ones who told me about it. So I went, and Ram Dass said, look, I'm the pitch man for Swami Muktananda. It was Muktananda's first time in the country. He didn't speak English very well. And so Ram Dass said, I'm gonna tell you about this, but the juice is coming from this guy, from Muktananda. But Ram Dass gave a meditation. I think it's from Ramana Maharshi. And the meditation goes something like this. He said, imagine that you're on a bridge standing over a river. And the river is everything that is in time and space. That includes all your sensations, all your emotions, all your thoughts. It includes the thought that you're standing on a bridge in a river, looking at the river. So I closed my eyes and I was doing this meditation. And after a while, I could tell, I kind of followed my breathing, and I could feel the blood flowing through my body. And it was at the point where I had the thought, I don't have to consciously keep doing anything to keep breathing. It's automatic. It was like that. I switched out of time and space. And what was outside of time and space was bliss. So it was such a sharp contrast to how I had come into that auditorium. Everything was perfect, everything was peaceful. And it was wonderful. So I was sitting there, and this went on for a while, and finally I opened up my eyes and I looked around the room. And when I looked around the room, I could see everybody glowing. I could see their auras. Everybody had just a beautiful color to them. The program went on. It ended. I was there with my girlfriend. I had been living with her for about 9 months at that point. And I lived in a house in Palo Alto. There were three other couples, so there were eight of us in a four-bedroom house on Alma Street. We walked out of Dinkelspiel Auditorium right across from the Student Union, and the trees were glowing, and the asphalt was alive, and we were all one. It was all part of the same thing. So I had driven over, but I couldn't drive home. My girlfriend drove us home. I talked to her for a while, and then I tried to go to sleep. So I lay in bed, and I found I couldn't sleep. So I got up, I went down in the middle of the night to the little living room. And all that night, I was flooded with the beginning of creation. There was God, and God wanted to make patterns. And the only way God could make patterns was in terms of God and not God. So that's where the first separation happened. The first duality was out of that creative urge. And as I said, I had no spiritual context to put this in. So I had been raised Catholic. I put it in terms of the creation of angels and archangels and the creation of men and women. And each of these dualities had such a strong need to reconnect, to reunite, and to be whole. So this just streamed through me. And when Patty, my girlfriend, got up, I was excited about it, and I talked to her about it. And she, of course, thought that I was just wacky. Some of the things I was able to do was I was able to go out of my body quite easily. I wasn't confined to my body. And so I would travel through space, through time and space. I could make the Earth the size of an atom, the Sun the size of an atom, and so I could go up to a much bigger universe, or I could go down to where atoms were the size of the Earth and the Sun. I wasn't caught in my brain, and without that resistance, I could engage my brain, and it could think very, very quickly. And so I thought, well, brain, solve the Vietnam War. And so it chugged away, and then thought, and thought, and thought, and it came up with the solution to the Vietnam War. And the solution was this. I went to visit, after a couple days, I went to visit my yoga friends, and I found that I could beam energy from my heart into their heart, and it produced an altered state of consciousness in them. At the time, I thought it was exactly the state of consciousness I was in. I don't think that's true in hindsight, but in the state of consciousness I was in and they got to, you couldn't harm anyone. You were one with everyone and everything. So the answer was obvious. You just go beam people and the state of consciousness will spread and we'll stop fighting. I still think that is the right solution. But at the time, it scared the crap out of Patty. So one of the reasons it did is because she said, well, okay, so how are you going to do this? I said, oh, I'll go to Washington and I'll be in the Congress and the Senate and Nixon and we'll be fine. What scared me even more was I found out that Nixon was actually coming to San Jose. And I said, I'm going to go by the side of the road, you know, and the motorcade goes by, I'll just beam him and that'll be that. I didn't eat or sleep for a week. I had no appetite, I couldn't sleep. And this was making everybody around me nervous. So there was a counselor at Stanford named Jim Fadiman. And my yoga friends knew him, and they had him come over to my house, and he tried to talk me out of this, talk me down. And he said, I'm a personal friend of Ram Dass's. Would you like me to arrange a meeting with you? And I looked at him, and I smiled, and I said, he's right here, we're one. I didn't need a meeting with him. So, again, this made particularly my girlfriend very nervous, so this is what happened next. that's Stanford Medical Center, and this is actually Stanford Hospital at that time. It was called Hoover Pavilion. There was a wing of it, and this was the mental hospital. Patty took me over to the Student Health Center, and if you don't eat or sleep for a week, your body gets pretty wound up. And so I could tell something was going on, so I went. I talked to them for about 10 minutes, and they had me over at Stanford Hospital just like that. They gave me Thorazine and knocked me out for 2 days. I slept for 2 days. And when I woke up, I was a patient in a mental ward. And I was given Stelazine, which is an antipsychotic. And I was given a drug called Cogentin, which counteracted the side effects of that. Some of which were strong constipation. And the weirdest one was I could see clearly out about, you know, a hand's length in front of my eye. And then for about a foot and a half beyond that, it was blurry. And then after that, it was clear again. So there I was in the hospital. I talked to the psychiatrist. I talked to the group. Interestingly enough, the medication didn't seem to affect at all my ability to travel. I could remember every book I had ever read, and I went through those and I looked for the dualities. And I did things like, I was a math major, so I thought, okay, I'm much different from when I went to see Muktananda. And in fact, then I divided my life up into thirds. There was the first part of my life until I fell out of the car. And then there was up till Muktananda and Ram Dass. And then there was after. And after was so different than the other two. I thought, okay, I don't know what you know about calculus, but calculus, if you have a curve, you can figure out the area under the curve by dividing, by drawing lines, straight lines from that curve down to the axis, and then you add up, you do it infinitely, and you add up all the lengths, and that tells you the area under the curve. And that's what integration is. Well, I thought, okay, I'm me before this experience, and I'm me after this experience. It's like I got split, at least into two. How about if I keep splitting myself? So what I did is I divided myself up into an infinite number of pieces, and I sent myself traveling in an infinite number of directions for an infinite time. And believe it or not, you come back, and there you are again. So this is all going on, but they're not understanding me at the hospital at all. They don't have a clue. There was group therapy there, and I could really have good insight into what was going on with other patients, but they didn't get me. I also noticed that when my friends came to visit, I was given medication every 4 hours. Up until as I got close to getting my medication again, I could talk more clearly. My tongue didn't feel so thick and blurry. And so I was starting to see that this medication didn't do me any good. I'm not going to go into all the details, but after 4 weeks, I decided that I wasn't going to stay in Stanford Hospital. My brother from Minnesota had come out, my older brother, and he talked to me. He knew I was different, but he's the first one that I talked to that didn't say, okay, you're crazy. So that gave me some kind of confidence to get out of the hospital. So I just left. And at that time, you could walk out a back gate and nobody did anything. So this leads me to my second near-death-like experience. So I went home to where Patty was, and she was still just crazily worried about me. And it was uncomfortable energetically for me to be around. My brother and I went up to Davis, where my aunt was the head surgical nurse at UC Davis Hospital, to visit. And while I was there, I stopped taking those drugs, including the cogentin, and so I became severely constipated there. And my aunt took me to a clinic, and they gave me a Fleet enema, and there was a triangular-shaped large piece of crap that tore its way through me and out. And subjectively, what that felt like was, actually, I felt like I was giving birth. It hurt that much. And when it came out of me, the Earth, the Sun, the Milky Way, all our galaxies went into that piece of crap, and I was out in space, traveling and traveling. And I got to a boundary line. And at that boundary line, I knew if I kept going past that boundary, my physical body was going to die. And I remember at that point, I remember, this is wonderful out here. What it feels like out of our bodies, I think, is wonderful. And it's very attractive, and it's immensely meaningful. And I think that's one of the features of this experience, is that I lost the human meaning. Everything in my life humanly dwindled into insignificance, including the strong love I had for Patty. And that's the only thing I remember bothering me even a little during this time. So I loved people, and I loved the Earth enough that I came back into this piece of shit. Voluntarily. So at any rate, I went home to Minnesota after that experience, and when I got there, I agreed to be checked into another hospital. And the reason I did that was my mom said, look, Stanford Hospital didn't do anything to check out if there's something physically wrong. So that made sense to me. I knew I was different. So she said, in order for you to get checked out physically, you've got to check into this hospital. So I said, okay, I'll do it. So I spent a week there in a hospital in St. Paul, Minnesota. And they did all these tests on me, and everything was fine. Everything was normal. No abnormalities whatsoever. But the psychiatrist there said to my mother, my dad had been traveling the whole week on a business trip, so he wasn't there. My mom was. The psychiatrist said to my mom, your son is suffering from acid flashbacks. He has a 60% chance of recovery if we medicate him. He has a 30% chance of recovery if you don't. And even though I was 21 at that time, apparently if both your parents agree to commit you, you can be committed. She agreed. I didn't know that at the time. But after a week, I decided I didn't want to be in the hospital anymore. And that whole week, I had refused medication. I knew that wasn't good for me. So I told the psychiatrist on a Saturday, I said, I want to check out. And he put me on a 72-hour hold. There was a misunderstanding. I had $150 in my pocket, which in those days was a fair amount of money, when I checked into the hospital. But they kept the bulk of that down at the main desk, and they only had 10 bucks up in the psychiatric ward for buying candy. So the psychiatrist thought that I was delusional. And I will say that one of the things that I learned from this is people treat you much, much differently if you've been labeled schizophrenic. So he put me on a 72-hour hold. He thought I was going to hurt myself. Now, this was the time I had seen One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest 6 months before this. And so I had visions of being medicated against my will, being given electroshock therapy, and eventually being lobotomized. And there was absolutely nothing I could do about that. And so this is one of the highlights of this experience for me, is I had to go back in my room, and I was on the fourth floor. The windows actually opened, but it was winter, and they had these teeny little ledges on the fourth floor. I might have gotten out, but I most likely would have fallen and killed myself. And I had to sit there and decide, okay, no. I found the strength inside to go through whatever they were going to go through. That was really important to me. So, I'll go back from this for a second. So, to make, again, a long story short, my dad came back from his trip. I got to sit on a hospital bed and listen to my psychiatrist tell my father, your son is a paranoid schizophrenic. He needs treatment. He's refusing treatment. My dad said, he had talked to me, said, he's different, but he seems reasonable to me. And the psychiatrist told him, he said, paranoid schizophrenics have the ability to recognize when people are going to be useful to them. And so to those people, they can appear normal. So I heard this and I thought, I am so totally screwed. If I'm normal, I'm still crazy. There was no out. But my father refused to sign the commitment papers, and I'm grateful to this day for that. And I went home with him because it was safe to do that. But for the first time in 2 months, I went from being completely open and completely loving to closed down and scared and angry. And that grounded me out of that experience. So my girlfriend came back for Christmas. We had that connection again. I went back to Stanford. I had gotten a bunch of incompletes from fall quarter. I made those up in winter quarter, and I took classes in spring quarter and graduated. It did get me out of the draft. It did, because after I graduated, I was called up. I went up on the bus to Oakland, and I had my Army physical, and I told them about my Muktananda experience and being hospitalized. I figured that was good for a 4F. They gave me a 1Y, which meant 1 year deferment. They said, if you're okay in a year, you're going in. But fortunately, the Vietnam War was winding down, and the next year my draft number was just high enough not to be drafted. So it did get me out of that. So that's what I looked like a couple years later. I was a long-haired hippie. My hair was down to my waist. And that's what I looked in my mid-20s. I got married in 1987. This is my wife, Chris. We had a couple kids. This is Mother Mira. In 93, I went to Germany and had a chance to be with her. This is the next part of what I wanted to talk about, which is, this is Chris and me and my son Logan. Kate is the one taking the picture. We're down in Abajania, Brazil, and this is in a posada there. And this was where the Casa de Dom Ignacio is, and that's where John of God, the Brazilian healer, is. So In 1992, they discovered that my wife, Chris, had thyroid cancer. And it had spread to the lymph nodes. And in our ignorance, when I heard that it spread to the lymph nodes, I thought she was dead. My kids were 2 and 4 at that time. And I remember I was at work and I heard that news and I just burst out crying. I was in the middle of my coworkers. So it's not true that if you have cancer spread to your lymph nodes, you're automatically dead. It was many years after that Chris passed. But the urgency of all this drove us. So her cancer never responded to the Western medical treatments. So usually thyroid cancer you can treat with radioactive iodine and it takes care of it right away. But hers didn't uptake the iodine. We found that out later. So it had spread to 10 lymph nodes. She had had a surgery in 92 that took out both sides of her, both all of her thyroid and those lymph nodes, her carotid artery, her jugular vein, not her carotid artery, and some muscles there. And we went through some years where tumors would grow. It turns out she had a bunch in her lungs. She had surgery on her lung. But it wasn't responding to anything, and so we were getting fairly desperate. So we went down to John of God in Brazil. Now, for those of you who don't know who John of God is, he's the most famous healer in Brazil currently. There are about a third of the population in Brazil consider themselves spiritists. Spiritism is the correct term. And spiritism people believe in reincarnation. They believe in evolution. So in past lifetimes, they believe you don't ever devolve, but you can stay stuck for a long time depending on your actions. And they think that you need people like St. Ignatius of Loyola and other people to act as kind of step-down transformers. If we perceive God directly, we're going to get fried. We need that energy to come down to a point where we can kind of consume it as humans. John of God is an unconscious medium. He channels. His personality gets out of the way, and he channels. The last I heard, it was about 32 spirits. Most of them are dead Brazilian doctors. This is a man with a second grade education, but he's doing elaborate medical procedures on people, some of which he does visibly. He cuts people open with a scalpel on stage with no anesthesia, no antiseptic. There's very little bleeding, there's no infection, and miraculous things happen. He does that to help people kind of to break your conception of what the laws of physics are. You know, how things work. And he shows you things that are just jar your brain. And that opens you for the entities to do their work with you. So when I went down there, I was skeptical about channeling and about entities. I wasn't sure. I was trying to be open, but I had pretty good prejudice against it. What I saw changed that completely. These are some other people that I was with down there. That's John of God, and he's actually doing a procedure on a Canadian woman named Cheryl, who factors into my story a little later. I'll come back to that. But that's me with John of God. So there were a number of amazing healings. So Chris felt like she kind of got washed clean, and the one thing I can say, I think objectively, is from when we went down there, she had a surgery in 2000 and then another one in a year and 9 months later, and in that time she had a golf ball sized tumor grow in her neck, So tumors were growing at kind of that rate. Following going to John of God, they grew very, very slowly until the very end. For me, there were several major healings. So the way the CASA works is you go in a long line, and right now he's seeing between 1,000 and 1,500 people a day through this line. He scans you for about 30 seconds, and he either gives you a prescription for some herbs, or tells you to sit in current, or do some other procedures that they have down there. Mostly you sit in what's called the current rooms, and there's several of them, and in there you're there for 4 hours or so, twice a day. And you're sitting with your eyes closed and your hands and feet straight, and you're praying and meditating. So I spent a lot of time in current that first week, and what I was praying and meditating about was I had this feeling ever since I fell out of the car and had that sort of punishment kind of feeling that I was not connected with the Spirit of God. So I prayed about that. And during those 3 days, I felt a melting inside of me. And I felt a presence, and I felt a warmth. And I was very grateful for that. On Saturday that first week, we went down to what's called the Sacred Waterfall. And this is a place where people go for healing. And it's not very big. It's maybe 18 inches in diameter, the water, and it falls for 10 or 12 feet. So it's cold, but it's not, it's no big deal. But the first time I went under the waterfall, it was like a sudden shock. And I found myself completely unable to breathe. You know, I'm sitting here gasping. And the thought occurs to me, okay, in the nice warm environment of the current room, you felt the presence of God. You better pray here when you really need it. And so I prayed to God, and then I could breathe. At that time, I was there with two other guys. We took turns. We went under the waterfall 3 times. And while I was waiting on this kind of creek, you know, rocky creek bed by the waterfall, I'm not visual. You know, when I see stuff, you know, I don't see it. You know, I can imagine it, I can feel it, but I don't hear it and I don't see it. But that day, I saw my little 3-year-old self, and he was standing or floating right out in front of me, about at arm's length. His arms were out to the side, like that. And he looked me right in the eye, and he rotated 180 degrees, and then he came back into me. And that's a lot of the healing. I think what happened was a fragment of me went off. And, you know, shamanic work, they talk about soul retrieval, and that's the nearest equivalent I can think of that happened with that. But he's with me. He's in me. And as near as I can tell, he's more closely connected to Spirit and God than I am, my adult self. So he helps me to do that. So I'll tell you about 2 more major healings down there. So the second week I was there, Chris had received an invisible operation. And when you get this, you sit and you close your eyes and you feel things. And even though no one has touched you, there are examples of people that have gone back after they've had an invisible operation. And they've had scans on their body, and they've seen things like tumors go away, but even stitches internally. So um, once you have an invisible operation, the protocol is you come back a week later and you go through what's called the revision line, where they look at what happened and see, are you done or do you need something else? So on the Thursday after that, so the CASA meets Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays. So on Thursday, she went through the revision line and I was sitting by myself in the current room. And I was praying then, I said, show me what my real relationship is with my wife. Just please show me that. And so I prayed and prayed and prayed. After that, the evening session was, or afternoon session was done, I came out and Chris was sitting outside. And I came up to her and I said, well, you know, so what happened, Chris, you know, in the revisions? He said, I went through the line and the John of God asked me, did I have a photograph of myself? And I said, yeah, I have one, but it's about from 16 years ago. Would that be okay? He said, yes. Bring that photograph through the line tomorrow. So, and then she looked at me and she was upset because she said, you know, that photo I was thinking of was in my change purse. And the change purse part of my purse was too heavy, so I left it home. So I reached into my wallet and I pulled out a picture that came from that same time and I gave it to her and I said, do you think this will do? And as soon as I gave her that picture, it was like someone had stabbed me through the heart with a knife. It was just devastating. And I just started bawling. So one of the translators comes, you know, from the CASA, comes out and pulls me back into the current room and he dumps a bunch of blessed water over me and so I go home. So I was, as I'm walking, it was about a 10-15 minute walk to where we were staying, that posada where you saw me and Chris and Logan. And I was telling Chris, you know, I think somehow I turned the care of you over to God in this. And so we went back and this guy on the right here is named Drew. He's actually passed away as well. He had just an extremely virulent form of leukemia. And he lived for about 5 years after this picture was taken, but he passed. Drew came up to me and he said, Brian, I saw you come out of the current room and it seemed like you had a profound experience. Tell me about it. So I told him what I just told you. And he said, well, you know, I think you've got it mostly right. You gave Chris's care back over to her with the picture. And Chris tomorrow is going to give her care over to God. And what I took from that, the healing I had was, I recognized how much kind of over-responsibility I was taking and how much I was acting out of terror of losing her. So I was trying to get her to try a macrobiotic diet, to go to John of God, to do anything she could so she could live. And it wasn't the right relationship. You know? So my relationship is with spirit, her relationship is with spirit, and if we're clear on that, then we can have the right kind of human connection. It was just so profound. I wish I could explain it better than that, but it just touched me so deeply. We went down to John of God in 2001. 2002, we took our kids. In 2003, Chris and I went back for a third time. She stayed for 2 weeks, and I stayed for an additional 3 weeks. During that time, on the fourth week I was there, when John of God incorporates St. Ignatius, it's palpable. It's like the sun came out in the room. It's just really bright and really powerful. he incorporated St. Ignatius that morning session. And in the afternoon session, I'm sitting in the front row of the current room where Joan of God is seeing people. And all of a sudden, I start sobbing. I'm crying and I'm having trouble breathing again. So you're supposed to be quiet in the current room. And there I am sobbing loudly and going, and finally one of the translators comes up to me and says, "Brian, do you want to go in front of the entity?" Meaning go in the line and have Joan of God help. And so before he got to that, there were several thoughts going through my head. One of them was, as I was having trouble breathing, I thought, "Oh my God, I'm dying." And I started praying, "Please let me go back home to say goodbye to my wife and children and then take me." And then I realized it was too late for that. Then I had the thought, I don't know how many of you have seen the movie The Sixth Sense, but Bruce Willis in that movie is a psychologist working with a young man who can see dead people. And it turns out that Bruce Willis was dead. And I thought, "Oh my God, I'm just like Bruce Willis in The Sixth Sense, only I died when I was 3 and fell out of the car, and all the rest of this has been imagination." And then after that, I was incapable of thought. So anyway, the translator and this other big guy got me under, one under each arm, and they started literally dragging my body towards John of God. And I get about 10 feet away from him, and normally John of God speaks in Portuguese, but I hear this booming voice. It says, "No, put him back. Let him do his spiritual work." So they put me back on the bench. This parade of people went by for at least another hour and a half or two. I'm just there. And pretty soon everybody gets up and leaves. And I'm sort of slumped over on the bench. And I can feel myself going through the fabric. It was like this naugahyde kind of cushion that was on these hard wooden benches. I was falling through that fabric to the other side. And it was wonderful there. Really wonderful there. And all of a sudden, this woman who was in charge of the recovery room, and that's the room where people that have get cut open or things, they usually pass out for a couple hours. And they put them in this recovery room and she helps them. She came in, she didn't speak much English, but she went, basically, "Look at me." And I knew what she was doing. And I was pissed at her, because it was so wonderful over there. So, she starts talking to me, and eventually she pulls me into another room, and they dump more blessed water on me. And she tells me to go sit outside with my back to a tree for a while. And I do that. And part of the point of me talking to you guys is that this stuff, I think, works on a level that it's really hard for our minds to figure out. Cheryl was a woman from Canada who could channel, and it turned out that me sitting with her, something about my energy field really amplified her ability to channel. And so we did some channeling sessions together, and she said, she contacted a group of entities, and they said to us, "We have a project for you if you're willing to do it." So we said, "Great, okay, we'll do it." And we started channeling, and it seemed like at first what this project was had something to do with an internal rewiring. So I'll come back to that, but just chronologically, I went home and when I was home, I started getting concerned because what was happening was when you're outside of time and space and during that whole Muktananda experience, the energies are tremendous. One of the things that happened to me, and I can go into this in more depth at a different time or privately, but when I went back to graduate school, I worked with a woman named Bonnie Greenwell, who's an expert in Kundalini experiences. And because I was having kriyas, which those looked like, for me, it was 45 minutes to an hour and a half of thrashing around in my bed like I was having a grand mal seizure. And it scared the crap out of Chris, but yeah. And you just have to kind of go along for the ride. Bonnie helped me figure out that when I fell out of the car, that actually activated my Kundalini energy on a very low level, and it took a long time. But after this feeling of dying at John of God, I was starting to get bothered because it was feeling a lot like these strong energies from the Muktananda Ramdas experience. And I've done my own therapy for more than 20 years. I was working with my psychologist about this. About 3 months after that experience, I was sitting in his office, and he said, "Brian, what are you afraid of?" And I said, "Errol, I'm afraid that I'm going to go non-functional again. But I can't do that. I have a wife and children to support. I can't go non-functional." As soon as I said that, my forebrain, which is where we do our executive planning and our decision making, it's where our ambition is, my forebrain literally got up out of the room and left. Never to be seen again. My ambition was gone. And Errol said, "You know, I work in the psychological to the spiritual, but if it gets too far into the spiritual, I'm over my head. And so I refer people to a friend of mine." And that guy is named Adyashanti. So I had a chance to go and talk with Adya. And it was the beginning of a fairly long association. I volunteered for a couple hours every other Friday for 7 years in his office. So it's been a good association for me. But I told Adya about Muktananda and Ram Dass, and I told him about what had happened down in Brazil, and that I was feeling these things, and I was scared. And so what Adya told me was, "I think what you had was a partial awakening. So you awakened to the transcendent, but you lost contact with the human. If you continue to awaken to the transcendent, you find that you're able to be both transcendent and human simultaneously." And it was so encouraging to me because I could feel him doing that. I think he's one of the few people I've met that are genuinely both transcendent and human simultaneously. So I think we all have our own flavor of that. And my perception of Adya is he's still really transcendent. And I'm more human. And one of the consequences of that is I think that people like me who've had a lot of trauma in their life have difficulty relating to that. But I'm convinced that we can do both. We can be fully human and transcendent. And that's kind of the work that I do. So, that's me about 4 years ago with my family. As John mentioned, Christy passed away 2.5 years ago, and that was a powerful experience. I've been exploring life and death for a while. 4 years ago, my dad passed away. 2.5 years ago, Chris did. This last New Year's, my mom passed away. So I've been working with that. So that's one of the things I wanted to share tonight. I think this is what we're all traveling through. And in my work as a therapist, I think I've started to see some of the things that get in the way of us doing that. So I wanted to have, I just gave you a long talk about my experiences. I wanted to have a bit of an experiential thing for you guys as well. And so I wanted to do that in two ways. The first is, so anything I invite you to do, please take care of yourself. If it doesn't make sense, if it doesn't feel right, don't do it. And just do what feels right to you. Okay? But so if you're willing, I want you to put your hands out in your lap with your palms face up. And I want you to think back to a time when your heart was completely open and vulnerable. So for many people, this might be a memory of like when I got my first puppy, or I saw butterflies in a meadow, or I saw the sunset at the beach, or I fell in love. All of those are examples of sort of the vulnerable side of us that really feels. And it's a useful thing to take something that's internal and externalize it by imagining that those parts of you are in one of your palms. So choose a palm. Some people like the left palm for that, some people like the right. It doesn't really matter. Put that down, that part of you, those parts of you down in your palm, and then get the sensory qualities of those parts of you. So the sensory, you can get that by saying, okay, is this warm or cold? Is it heavy or light? Is it light colored or dark colored? Is it rigid or flexible? And you get a feeling for the qualities, the sensory qualities of this. Okay. Now in your right hand or the other hand, put the parts of you who come into existence to protect those other side. So this is your executive manager. It's your critic. It's the parts of us that might build walls, or it might try to shove the feeling part of us out of our awareness, because these parts are interested in being safe and functional. And sometimes intense emotion threatens functionality. So do the same thing. Get the sensory qualities of these parts. So again, are they warm or cold, soft or hard, rigid or flexible, light or heavy, colors, smell? Now, if you find yourself liking one side more than the other, that's your critic. That's your sorting into good or bad kind of noticing. Put that part of you down in the managing and protector part hand, so that what's left in the middle is objective witnessing. It's curious, it's compassionate. And to me, it's the bridge to this deeper self. So you can go back and forth between both of these sides. This exercise is really useful to do just to be able to discern what's this deeper kind of witnessing. Because that deeper witnessing gets covered up. Usually what people do is lots of us spend most of our time in the getting on with life parts that are, you know, the managing and protector kinds of parts. But other times the emotional side will take over. And both of those can obscure this objective witnessing. So you can let that go. There's more to do with that exercise if anybody's ever curious about it, and I'd be happy to talk to people about that. But I started this project, and so this is my other facet here that I'll talk about. I was doing this channeling with Cheryl, and Cheryl was going blind. She had a condition called retinosis pigmentitis or something like that. And it's a condition that turns you fully blind. She had placed a lot of hope in John of God healing that. And when she continued to go blind, she turned away from it all. So she got out of the picture with this. By that time, I had learned something really important that I also wanted to share with you guys, which is, I think we all can perceive the, you know, inward entities, inward, you know, the life on the other side. I think we can all perceive that, but we don't know it. And one of the things that blocked me, I thought I was about as perceptual inwardly as a stone. I really did. And it was because I was looking for that perception in a specific form. I wanted to see it, or I wanted to hear it. And it turns out that that's not how I work. I get deep feelings. I get deep knowings. And so the thing that helped me with that is I learned about muscle testing. And I want to demonstrate that today, if anybody's willing. But I use muscle testing to help gain my confidence in my own intuition, my own inner perception. Because it would help verify that I wasn't just making stuff up in my head. And that was really important for me. So I did that, and about 4 years ago, there was a group of entities that we had contacted in this channeling, and they said, "Brian, we want you to have a group." And for the last 3.5 years, I've had a group that meets. They said, "You have to meet the first Saturday of the month and meet from 9 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon." I thought, "Oh, that's a long time." But it turns out that it's an appropriate time. And what we do in that group is we work with discarnate entities, with earthbound spirits that are trapped. We do remote healing. And we'll work, you know, do healing with, you know, anybody in the group that wants us to work. So I wanted to demonstrate that if there's any brave volunteers in this group.
I thought having an earthbound attachment is a good thing. I mean, that's it.
So what I know about this,
very interesting. So I'm
not going to do something that would be against your will and your beliefs. So if you want to hold on to this attachment, you're welcome to do it.
No. If you think the attachment is not good for me, I don't understand the attachment.
My experience is that, so this is from, again, this is from the spiritism beliefs in Brazil. And as I said, a third of the population goes weekly to a center to work on stuff like this. So in our culture, it's weird, but down there, it's pretty straightforward. What they think is that they believe in past lives, and they think that, so I'll say it through here.
They think that some lives, we don't behave very well. And people get upset, like if we killed them or stolen from them or things like that. And sometimes, if it's so upsetting, instead of going into the light and then going through the next step of evolution, of their evolution, they stay stuck and earthbound. And they stick on to, even if the person has reincarnated, they stick on to their spirit. And then they're filling them with negativity. And if they're hitchhiking, they're really energetically draining them. Right? So, and there's a lot of reasons why spirits don't want to go into the light. Sometimes we're ashamed of what we've done and we're afraid of judgment. And so what they do is they have mediums that can perceive these spirits and they counsel them. It's not a exorcism kind of demonic thing usually, although there are dark energies. The darkest energy I've ever come across is I worked with a woman who had been to Rwanda, and there was a spirit that attached to her that its whole purpose was to spread AIDS throughout Africa. That was really dark. So you can find that occasionally, but it's not to be alarmed about. It's just, I think this is just levels of unconsciousness and that. But so for you, we'll check this out.
Sure.
And
I mean, it's an interesting experience on the one hand, right. And on another hand, the way I understood it, my spirit is a ball of energy, kind of.
Yeah.
And there's another ball of energy that's entangled in it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's sort of it's draining some of your energy, so it can have a pseudo life.
Right. Let's get rid of it.
Okay. So.
So, relax for a sec. I'm gonna hold your arm if that's okay, so we can be in contact. So.
Well, I thought you wanted me to resist.
I know. I'll try to be clearer.
Okay.
So, we use this muscle testing as both a way of connecting deeper to your own intuition. And as you gain more confidence through the muscle testing, what I found is that the intuition comes in clearer and the perception comes clearer. So it's not an oracle. We're not using this to figure out what decisions we should make or anything. We're using it to confirm our intuition. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So I got to put this down. So if you can't hear, I'm sorry. But
So, say we need to know more about who the spirit is.
We need to know more about who the spirit is.
Say it's not helpful, it's not useful to know more about the spirit.
It's not helpful or useful to know more about the spirit.
So,
what happened?
So, when I said we need to know more about the spirit, your arm went weak. When I said we don't need to know more about the spirit, your arm is strong. So we can have the spirit removed. There's no information, there's no, like sometimes it'll be your, a deceased father or a sister or it's somebody that there's a relationship with, and it's helpful to know who they are and what's going on with them. But in your case, this is just an entity that's been kind of a hitchhiker.
Mm-hmm. Is it possible it's interfering in our interaction?
Say the spirit is interfering in our interaction.
The spirit is interfering in our interaction.
say it's not interfering.
It's not interfering with our district.
It is interfering. Yeah, it's trying.
Very interesting.
But that's okay.
This isn't something that my personality is particularly wanting to be doing, you know. And my on a personality level, I don't know how to do this. What I do know in the personality level how to do is to call on the help of the lighted beings that do know how to handle this, and they do the work. And they use your and my awareness as an anchor so that they can actually do this work. Okay, so what I want you to do is call on your spirit guide or guides, your guardian angels, your protector spirits, and do this in the form, ask for only help from beings who are acting in your highest interest and the highest interest of all beings.
Well, I'm asking that being that's been saving my life.
Okay.
Say this. The being that's saving my life is a different being than this entity that's attached.
The being that's been saving my life is a different being than the one that is attached.
Yep, that's real strong. Okay, so...
Okay, well, that's good news.
Yeah, so we have positive beings that are working with us. And they're not attached, and they're not draining us, they're just helping. And so we think, okay, this thought is coming from me. Sometimes it's not. It's coming from either a higher spirit, or in this case, maybe a negative, negative entity. So what we're going to do is I want you to ask that being who's been helping you, and I'm going to ask the beings that work with me to basically surround this being that's earthbound.
Okay?
This earthbound spirit doesn't know that he's dead. Say that.
This earthbound spirit does not know that he's dead.
Yep. It is a male spirit.
It is a male spirit.
Yep. So we're gonna
ask your lighted being and my guides to help this man who died. He died, but he doesn't know.
And he didn't go to the afterworld.
He didn't go to the afterworld, and he
managed to entangle
into your spaces, and he doesn't even know he's dead physically.
Wow.
That's actually fairly
common.
What does
he think?
He thinks he's confused. He thinks that he's not sure what is happening.
He's seeing his body?
He's seeing a body. He's upset because people don't respond to him the way they used to.
But he's not seeing, if he's dead, his body's gone.
But his spiritual body is not gone.
But what, is he seeing a physical body?
He thinks it's a physical body, but it's not.
Oh, he's seeing an imagined physical body. But why does he need this entanglement?
So he can live.
It's giving him life energy.
It's giving him some life energy so he can hang out here.
I see.
Okay. So ask yourself, is there anything in me that wants to hold on to this?
No.
No. Okay. So I want you to give permission to your guide and to the other lighted beings that are working with us to remove this entity.
Of course.
Okay. So just do that.
It's like a parasite.
Yeah. When you scan through your body, do you find him attached to anyone, one place? Well, I think it's because he was removed. My sense was he was kind of in over here.
It was here.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so to say this, this entity has been removed.
This entity has been removed.
So he's been taken to a place where he won't do any harm.
He's been taken to a place where he would not do any harm. Yeah, that was good.
He's been taken to a place that what?
He won't. So the way these guys work is that they'll take a confused earthbound spirit to a place into the light where they won't do any harm to anyone else. So your body says you're free.
Thank you very much.
Let's take a break and then let's meet back at 9 and I'll answer any questions people have. Okay, so let's open the floor and see what's on your mind. Want to give them the mic?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Well, I hope this is not too ignorant, but my understanding of after-death, of near-death experiences were only in situations where people were clinically dead and had an experience. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, I can comment on that. So, among other things, if you read this monthly NDE email that came out yesterday, I think. So it starts out, in this unusual account, a young person self-induces a near-death-like experience through a type of meditation. So, and when you read this account, he's talking about traveling up and down, just like I did. And there were several other things that just struck me as really similar. This feeling of unity and the pure ecstasy of what it was like. So at the Newport Beach conference in August, they were talking about people who had near-death experiences when their loved one, they were sitting with their loved one who was passing. Right?
Shared
near-death experiences. So
we're changing the definition. INSPOR is changing the definition because it used to be it was a near-death experience. If left alone, you would have died.
Right.
Whether or not you were clinically dead, and we have to change that because of what your friends had in that book. Was it Gross or what's the last name?
Grock.
Stan Grock.
They're changing
yeah.
the definition, and we're moving to that definition, which is it's going to be a whole lot of things.
Right.
But it's very hard to do because
there's a lot of loyalty, you know,
yeah.
to that.
Yeah.
But I mean that's one of the reasons I wanted to come and talk is that I really think that we're all getting to the same place, whether we get there through clinically dying or through when my wife passed, I felt such a feeling of joy and love coming from her. And it wasn't her personality, it was coming through something bigger.
Almost all the whole complete NDE, but I was only in a coma.
Right.
So by that definition, which some people want to apply, they don't want to speak.
Right.
Because I didn't
right.
have a real near-death experience.
Yep.
I'm on the board, but
can I add something, Brian?
Sure, please.
To give another answer to your question, sir, you don't have to be dead. Another way is if you think you're going to be dead. For instance, if you see a semi-truck coming at you and you think you're going to hit it, you can have an out-of-body experience. So no, you don't have to be dead.
Well, don't think all those...
We're talking about basically transitioning into the other realm, okay? And that can be, I understand, done in many different ways. But it's good to define near death when it's clinically death.
Yeah, I agree.
It's a question of terminology.
Yeah. So this exercise I asked you all to do, where you were holding in your hands the parts of you, I really think that if you do that thoroughly and you get those parts out of the way, you touch this deeper place that is outside of time and space. And that has that just pure objective witnessing, that's curious and compassionate, it's changeless, and it's really comforting, because these parts that were in our hands sometimes aren't okay. They're wounded, they're protective, they're not okay, and I think they're associated with a part of us that does die. But this deeper part is changeless. And so if these parts in your hands will ask for contact and connection with this deeper you, it's extremely comforting, because you feel this okayness even when they're not okay. So it's a profound exercise. We went through it really quickly. But our fear contracts us, right? And so I went for many years, and one of the things I didn't mention in my story is that I, after I was locked up and I sat there listening to them call me a paranoid schizophrenic, which, by the way, was clearly a misdiagnosis. To be schizophrenic, you have to have symptoms for a minimum of 6 months. That's part of the definition of schizophrenia. And I had had symptoms for several weeks. So it was just clearly a misdiagnosis. And it was done, as far as I could tell, from a well-meaning psychiatrist, but just ignorant.
And I don't believe a well-meaning psychiatrist would say, sorry. A lot of those people.
Yeah. Well, but after that, I carried around for many years, unconsciously, the sense that I was crazy. Right? It wasn't until 1990, 20 years later, I happened to get an invitation to a conference called the Energies of Transformation, which was put on by the Spiritual Emergence Network, which the Groffs founded, and which I was a phone volunteer for in a couple of years in the early 90s. They had a conference at Asilomar where 500 people came, and part of that conference was they had a group of about 20 of us that sat around telling spiritual emergence kinds of stories. And I heard my story, identical story, from a number of different people. And something in me eased, and I said, oh, this is what this is. That's really important. Yeah. Okay. So on the psychological, most of us have our awareness in our critic. It's the sorting into good or bad, you know. So objective witnessing, if you look at this podium, you'll see, okay, that it's got brown colored wood and a black centerpiece there, black rectangle. Objective witnessing just sees that as it is. Critical kind of noticing looks at that, and it adds this mental component, which is, oh, I've got an internal list that I think is good and an internal list I think is bad. And so it's always comparing, and it's adding this mental step that basically takes us out of the direct experience of that. And the critic is that kind of noticing, is a protective function that separates us. So if we're not, we need the critic, we need the discernment of the critic, we're not trying to get rid of it, but we don't want to be 100% identified with it unconsciously, because we lose our objectivity, we lose our witnessing. When I fell out of the car, and then later I was trying to explore that, I would find my consciousness would either veer away from it because it was so painful, or I would become my three-year-old who is really hurting. When you do that, healing does not happen. Right? So it's the critical kind of noticing that veers away from it. It's the objective witnessing that accepts it and lets it flow through, and that helps us make sense out of it. So that's the psychological part of this. The spiritual part of it is, that changeless noticing is the thing we're flowing through. And it will profoundly change these parts that we put into our hands if you will have awareness from those parts into that. And I think that free will, you know, is an actual phenomenon. This deeper part of us does not override, even on an unconscious level, if we disconnect from it. So not only do these parts in our hands need to ask for help from this deeper part of us, we have to give permission. If we give permission, and then we're helped, and we find perspective, and we make sense of things that are too traumatic otherwise.
Yeah. When you mentioned the heart energies, what do you mean by it? You think there's some energies seated in the heart, or there it's just a saying?
I think that there are energies from your heart and the heart chakra, and there's specific colors that go with the different energies, and there's different systems. I've learned several, actually. And so I'm kind of keeping it deliberately vague. I think most of us can relate to just heart feeling energy and mind kind of energy.
So you think it's a feeling rather than some energy associated with a physical heart?
I think it's more associated with your heart center than the physical heart. But I think it's all energy.
Yes.
Right?
Thank you.
Okay, John has a question here.
Yeah. I'll get to you.
Were you not answering?
No, I'm done. There's another question after that. No, give it to John first. Give it to John first, and then it's okay.
Okay. My questions are about the muscle testing.
Yes.
And I'm wondering how much confidence you have in those results, and whether, like, an entangled spirit could influence the results, and whether the person you're testing could perhaps influence them by having a strong wish for what the outcome they would like it to be.
Yes.
And so forth. Okay. Following.
So, yeah, I do. So let me try to answer that. So I first learned about muscle testing 40 years ago or something. I think chiropractors used to use this to test supplements and whether they were good for you or not. And there's this thing called energy psychology, where they do acupressure point tapping, and they use muscle testing to test that. I have used it, both have gone through it personally and have used it with some of my clients, where you can use it to actually tap into past life experiences and do healing with that. It's a little tricky in the sense that, like I did a group a couple weekends ago down in Southern California, and I found a woman who tested opposite. So when we said, you know, your name is Georgina, it went weak when her name really, it isn't Georgina, but it went weak, and so she would test the opposite. And that was really tricky to work with, because it's like, you know, you get into a paradox with a double negative. So there are some times, and there are conditions. So Donna Eden has got a book called Energy Medicine, and she describes a condition called homolateral. She'll use muscle testing, and basically, she'll draw an X on a piece of paper, and then two parallel lines, and she'll muscle test while you're looking at the X and looking at the parallel lines. And you should test strong on the X, because our energies internally cross over, just like left brain controls right body. And if you test strong, you won't test strong on both. I've done this with hundreds and hundreds of people, and I've never had it where it tested strong on both. If it tests strong on the parallel lines, it means your energies are flowing up and down. And she says that means your immune system isn't working properly, you're confused more. You want to check that, because if, for instance, you're doing a therapy session with somebody and they're homolateral, it doesn't stick. They're just wasting their time and money. So there's some exercises you can do that straighten that out. So in terms of whether it's 100% accurate, I would say in general, yes, it is. I think it bypasses our brain, our mind. And that's why I like it so much, because our mind does trick us. And well, it influences, but it's, I think it's a chi or key energy phenomenon that keeps it strong or weak. And so I think it's influenced by the mind, but it's not overridden by the mind. So it's a really good question. I haven't seen objective scientific research about it. I've worked with this way at least 20 years, and I get consistent results. So I have a lot of confidence in it.
So, okay, Deborah has a question.
When a relative passes away, is there a way, because I just kind of assume that, I knew somebody who passed away this past Saturday. That's why I'm asking the question. And I just kind of assumed that he went to a better place. But you were talking about people who get stuck between here and wherever we go, supposedly when we leave these bodies. Is there a way a person can tell if that person actually went to a better place or if they're stuck?
You can use your intuition. And if you can really trust your intuition, that's good enough. If you're like me, it really helps to do muscle testing and confirm this. So my mom passed away New Year's Eve, 92-year-old mom. I went and said goodbye to her, but I wasn't able to be there when she passed. I was in Toronto doing a group of 12 of us doing the same sort of thing. And we worked with my mom's spirit. And it turns out that my mom didn't know she was dead, was very, very confused. And I had tried to talk her through it when I was seeing her. She had a stroke and couldn't talk anymore. And, you know, there was a couple of weeks between this massive stroke that cut off all the blood to the left side of her brain and her passing. And in the middle of that, I was talking to her about all this. And I hoped that I had helped her through, but it turns out that she needed working with a group, and so we helped her to move into the light and then go. She was taken to like a rehab place. I think when we pass, some of the qualities of the other side are that we travel by thought, just by thinking, so we're instantly there. My mom had said, the last phone conversation I had with her, where she could talk, she said, "I'm really looking forward to going to heaven and flying around." And I said, "Mom, I think you can do that, because this is how it works. And just by thinking that, you can go." But she was stuck. And
why was she stuck?
She was stuck because I think it's because what you expect, right? When you pass, if you're not knowing, she didn't know she died. That's what happened to my mom. She thought she was still in some vague, hospital kind of setting or something. And so I think you get worked with after you pass if you're open to it. If you think that you just die and that's it, I think a lot of those people end up in a very dark place. And it's very confusing. But if you're spiritual and you are asking for help,
I think you're taken into a place where, you know, they help you heal. Our thoughts manifest when we're not in our physical body, and they create things. So if you're thinking, I've still got this massive blood block in my brain, that's how you are over there. But the people over there know how to work with that and help you to clear it up.
How did you know your mom was dumb? I mean, after she passed away, how did you know?
Because we as a group tuned in. So you start developing a better capacity to pick these things up, but it's all filtered through our personalities. And so I really appreciate working in a group where you're getting other people tuning in as well, and we can kind of validate one another or correct one another. So we as a group tuned into my mom, and that's what we got. And I checked it with muscle testing, and that's what it told me. So do I know 100%, you know, with no doubt whatsoever that my mom got stuck and then that she passed on? No, but it's what I really, really think and believe.
Do you have any experience too, like, do prayers actually help people pass on and, you know, get to a better place if they get stuck?
I believe so, yes.
Okay.